from the high desert of Southern California and on the web at praiseyahuwah.com, announcing the kingdom of Yahuwah. And now it's time for truth with your servant host, Denya Cajaliero.
Good morning, family of Yahuwah, or good afternoon, or good evening, wherever you are. Dia and I, Denya Cajaliero, wish to thank you for being here with us on this day. Within our gates, this day is our Shabbat day, and we hope you are blessed this day, and that you will be blessed in whatever day of the week your gate is for your family, until the day that Yahuwah brings us all together. We pray and we look forward to his imminent return. Well, today, Yahuwah has put upon my heart to talk about the Trinity doctrine a little bit. Not a heavy discussion, because it's not really a deep topic, actually. It's very straightforward. We talked last week about having spiritual glasses and putting those on. Your bifocals, right? Because bifocals help you to see, not only to see better if your eyes are failing, which in this world our eyes are failing, but bifocals also help us to see things at two different levels, so that we can compare and that we can test all things. And Yahuwah definitely allows us to do this through his loving Ruach. And it's a gift that Yahuwah gives us, and some of us can see things so clearly, and yet for many others it may not be so clear. So we all have different gifts, and Yahuwah will use us in different ways, especially in the latter days. We look at Amos 8:11, which we've talked about before. See, the days are coming, declares the Master Yahuwah, that I shall send a hunger in the land, not a hunger for bread, nor a thirst for water, but for hearing the words of Yahuwah. Now, if everybody has a Bible in their house, if everybody has a church on the corner, how could this scripture ever possibly come to be? Well, that's because Yahuwah no longer resides in churches or temples or synagogues. He no longer builds his temple on this earth in the form of a building or an organization like a church or religion, but he builds it within you, his people. You are his temple, the scriptures say clearly, and he resides within you. And so the hunger for bread and the thirst for water, that comes because there are people, they're eating empty calories, if you will. You've heard about how junk food is empty calories because it's food. It fills you, but it doesn't nourish. Well, that's exactly what the churches are, and even the Bibles are becoming as a result of various deceptive changes, as Paul talks about, would happen in the latter days, that they would believe the lies, and they do and are believing the twisted deceptions of the lies that are occurring. These lies and deceptions are both occurring by the words of the mouths of these men who do not know or cannot see, and they're occurring supernaturally by way of things that we don't fully understand. We know that technology and such with regards to CERN and the quantum changes that are occurring, the Mandela effect, if you will, these are truly happening, and yet Yahuwah gives you his what? Set apart spirit so that you can see beyond these things. It says that his people are not going to be blind to these changes. Now, some of even his very elect possibly can be fooled, it says. It does say that. That gives us a moment for pause. It's very humbling. We have to be careful. However, we don't shrink back. We move forward in faith and expectation. So even though these changes are taking place by CERN, a name taken after an ancient god. Did you know that? CERN is from another god. And that also the Shiva that they have in front of their building, that goddess type Shiva, with all the arms and the legs and all that weird snake stuff and whatnot. That is Destroyer and Deceiver. That's what Shiva is the goddess of. So isn't it interesting? Because deception is exactly what the scriptures say would occur in the latter days. And so there's a thirst for bread and water, the hunger. And it is because all of these empty calories that are coming from churches. So these empty calories, we're going to try to get people off of the fast food of religion and bring them to the real bread of Yahuwah and drink. Because this water is free and the bread is free and it is to nourish you and it is to bring you what Yahuwah brings to us. Because right now is extremely pivotal in where we are as Yahuwah's people. A very pivotal time. It's humbling for me. Today I turned 50, at least birth years. And 50 years ago, I never saw my journey being where it is today, although I've always known that I would be close to my Creator and that I would always love Him and that He would always love me. And so today is kind of one of these days where I just feel the Spirit, brothers and sisters, of Yahuwah this morning. And I feel Him greater than I think I ever have in my heart. And I want to share and talk about the Spirit today with you. I want to talk about the Father, and I want to talk about the Son. And I want to talk about the so-called doctrine of Trinity, which occurs nowhere in Scripture. Well, not yet anyway. With Mandela effect changes, there never was the word Easter in the Bible either. And when I was a kid and I was a Jehovah's Witness, I used to go from door to door and see Jehovah's Witnesses. They have one thing right, I will say, and that is they are very anti all these worldly traditions and holidays. And so they are right on the money. They used to have a lot of things right, but they steered away from Yahuwah because, again, they don't have the eyeglasses to see the truth anymore. He has completely removed their ability to see the truth of things. But when I was a kid, I would go to the door and I would talk to people and I would discuss the Bible and we would sit down in their living rooms and we would share information, especially about the holidays, because this was such an easy topic to show the hypocrisy in, right? To wake people up. You could tell if there was a spark of interest just by going into that. They'd either shut you down or they'd say, well, you know, I've always felt that there's something not right about this or that, right? Then, you know, you had an open door for conversion possibilities, okay? And what a ridiculous thing that was to try to convert people when we know that Yahuwah is the one who will absolutely convert the hearts and minds of men and women. But we're on a mission, if you will, literally and figuratively. And as a regular pioneer, I would go to their houses. We would talk about this, and we would study from our Bibles, Jehovah's Witness Bibles. We would study from their various Bibles. So I became quite familiar with a lot of different translations because you'd run into every single one. And one of the things we used to talk about was, with regards to holidays, of course, we talk about Christmas. We talk about the scriptures that show that Christmas is absolutely abhorrent and how simple and straightforward it is if you have eyes to see. But then we would talk about Easter and how this word Easter was never in any Bible. Isn't that amazing? It was never in any Bible. The most common Bible that we would be up against when we would be out in field service would be the King James Version Bible. Well, now King James Version has Easter in it. Isn't that amazing? Poof. All of a sudden, going back centuries and centuries, the original writings all the way down through all these translations, they all have Easter now. So when we talk about the word Trinity not being in Bibles, it very well may one day be put in the Bible, brothers and sisters, which is why we need to know our scriptures. That's why Yahuwah says that that I shall send a hunger in the land, nor not a hunger for bread, nor a thirst for water, but for hearing the words of Yahuwah. See, not reading the words, because eventually they're not going to be able to read the words of Yahuwah for various reasons. They're only going to be able to hear it, and you and I have been chosen to declare it. And it says, they shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall diligently search, seeking the word of Yahuwah, but they shall not find it. It's hard to find something that you can only hear, which means there's going to be very few people who are going to declare the truth of the words of Yahuwah. But we pray that that is exactly what we are doing today. First, I want to start off with talking about some of the fundamentals as we see it from Scripture. First of all, Yahuwah the Father. Yahuwah the Father is the grand creator of all things, because He always was, the Scriptures say, right? He always existed since before the foundations of the earth, since before the creation of the various dimensions, and since before the angels, since before our Master, since before all things Yahuwah created. And we know this, and we know His name is Yahuwah, and we have various teachings and recordings, YouTube videos there that show and declare the great name of Yahuwah. Is it Brother Bennett? I consider him a brother. We may not be right on the same page on everything, but but certainly I know and see his love for Yahuwah from his words, and I his teachings on the name of Yahuwah is spot on. We have that video on our website as well. If you want one quality video on understanding the basic understanding of the name of Yahuwah, the spelling of it, and getting that right, there is a great video there. We also have an older video on our YouTube channel as well, which discusses the name of Yahuwah, which I want to say we've got so many videos. We've got videos on there that have as much as 10,000 hits, just one video, and we praise Yahuwah for that, because slowly He brings in and slowly He increases the amount of subscribers, which is awesome, because that tells us that there are people that are hungry for the truth, and they're searching and they're seeking and they're finding. Because for the most part, those who subscribe stay. We don't tend to go backwards on our subscription. We just seem to consistently move forward. And we love you all, brothers and sisters. Thank you for that. We don't know you. We're going to know you one day. But right now we don't know you, because you're there, we're here, but we know you though. We know your heart. We know what you go through. We know where you're coming from, and you're seeking mind, and your righteous zeal, not an empty false calorie zeal like the world has, this born again zeal, but you have a true zeal for the truth. You hunger for it, and you search for it, and it says you'll find it, and you are finding it. And so we praise Yahuwah that you are finding it. You're finding it because you have Yahuwah's spirit. He says that if you seek, you will find, and it is people will see. So Amos 8:12, when it talks about how they'll search all over, but they shall not find it, obviously this is referring to those people that are not His. The 99.9% of the world, but you are finding it, and you have found it, and we praise Yahuwah for that here at praiseyahuwah.com. Well, so Yahuwah is the Father, no doubt about it, and what we believe is that Yahuwah created His Son, because He created all things, and we're going to talk about why that is. Some scriptures today that show that. And He also, there's in D and I, through the years and since my childhood, I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness, so I had a firm understanding on the Trinity doctrine, but my wife Dia, she kind of wasn't firm in these things. So it's very, very simple for her to kind of look at things with an open mind and heart, and see the logic without the baggage of things. And I myself have some baggage. For instance, I was taught that Jehovah was the Father, that Jesus was the Son, and that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, they call it, was the active force of Yahuwah. Now, that these were not three, that these were not one in three. And this is true, but that's about as far as it went. There were no deeper teachings on that. And then as I left that world many decades ago now, I started in my mind thinking about different things, and I started learning more and more about the relationship there, beyond just that one-dimensional teaching that the Jehovah's Witnesses taught. And so, as I came to know Yahuwah, I was taught that the Father is a person, and I was taught that the set-apart Spirit is an actual entity, or being, or angel. So I thought, okay, well, if that's, you know, this is what a lot of people who believe in Yahuwah, seems like they're believing, and then they believe that Yahuwah, Shua is the Son, and he's a separate thing, so all three are separate. Well, that was interesting for a time, and I have to say that I went along with that for a time, because I didn't really know. But as I started reading scriptures and learning more and more, I started figuring out that the set-apart Spirit of Yahuwah is actually, based on what I can read in scripture, not that of a separate named being. See, just about every being, every entity in scripture has a name. And especially if you know, we're reading scripture, we see that. So there are some scriptures we're going to read today, which we're going to get more into this topic. But first, let's as long as we know the basics of the Father and the Son and the Spirit, is the Spirit an angel or an entity separate of Yahuwah? Is it part of Yahuwah's active force? Is it part of Him? Is it also part of the Son or not part of the Son? These are the questions we want to talk about today. But first, let's just get right into it here. Turn in your scriptures to John chapter 5 and verse 20. All right, John chapter 5, verse 20. And you can turn from any Bible. You don't have to use any specific Bible, because all scriptures are available for us to learn from, and it's good to look at it from different angles as you're reading the scriptures. Because when you do, you get more insights on things. So I love that. John 5:20, and we're reading from the Scriptures, the 1998 version. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he himself does. And greater works than these he's going to show him in order that you marvel. Now, isn't that interesting? So he's going to show his Son things that he doesn't know yet. And we know that because our Savior, Yahuwah, when he was on earth, he said that you know, and the scripture was stated also that he would not know the day, the hour of his actual coming. Now, if he was part of Yahuwah the Father, where he was actually the Almighty, as the world teaches, he would be able to know the truth of things, all things, because he would be the Father. But there's a reason why there's a distinction where it says the Father and the Son, so that we can truly understand. It's a very basic concept. Only man makes it complicated, right? But that's exactly how the world is. Overcomplicates everything, and then they lose sight of anything that might be a key to them. So turn now to Matthew 1, verse 18, and let's look at why now, and that was a basic scripture that the Father and the Son are separate, sets a foundation. We know that our Master was born of his mother, Miriam, and that Yahuwah was the Father. He put the seed in her. Ah, or did he? Now, if you turn to Matthew 1:18 together, let's read that scripture. Matthew 1, verse 18. It says, but the birth of Yahuwah, Messiah, was as follows. After his mother Miriam was engaged to Yosef, before they came together, she was found to be pregnant from the set-apart spirit. Now, wait a minute. If the set-apart spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, as it's referred to, or there's a lot of different ways, but let's just say set-apart spirit of Yahuwah, if that was an actual angel on its own, then our master would not be pregnant from the Father. He'd be pregnant from another angel. And that's an important concept, because our master is the son of our Creator, directly from him. And yet, it says that he was found to be pregnant from the set-apart spirit, because the set-apart spirit is part of and is Yahuwah. So there's Yahuwah the Father, and there is Yahuwah the set-apart spirit. Now, verse 20, if you go a little further down, it says, but while he thought about this, see, a messenger of Yahuwah appeared to him in a dream, saying, Yosef, son of Dawud, do not be afraid to take Miriam as your wife, for that which is in her was brought forth from the set-apart spirit. So now we have a two-part double witness to the fact. Whenever Scripture, especially in the same chapter, says the same thing twice, it's telling you, it's putting extra emphasis on it for you to know and understand. Because in a story, there's really no need to repeat yourself over and over, unless it's something that is very important to take note of. So this is how we do believe and know that the set-apart spirit of Yahuwah is Him. It's His, truly His active force. And although I was taught this as a child, and then went a different way slightly, which never really settled right into my heart, I ended up realizing that this is truly truth. And that this set-apart spirit is truly, this Ruach is truly Yahuwah Himself. And we don't fully understand how the Almighty is the Almighty with our puny little brains, right? But we know that He does have abilities beyond that of anyone or anything. So all things are possible with Him. And so the force, if you will, of Yahuwah, the spirit of Yahuwah, the active workings and movement of Yahuwah is truly Yahuwah. It is part of Him. Now let's turn to Matthew, or rather Luke 1:35. We'll read this next scripture. Luke 1, verse 35. And it says, the messenger answering said to her, the set-apart spirit shall come upon you, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow you. And for that reason, the set-apart one born of you shall be called the son of Eloiam. So, we show again that the set-apart spirit here is what? That it is of the Most High, you see, and that it is His active force. And so it helps to solidify exactly what we read in Matthew as another witness. Now turn to John 14:26. John 14 and verse 26. It says there, but the Helper, the set-apart Spirit, whom the Father shall send in my name. Now wait a minute. This is Master talking, right? Yes. So what is the name of our Father? It's Yahuwah. What is the name of His set-apart spirit? It's Yahuwah. Because why? Because it is part of Yahuwah. It couldn't be called anything else. It is Him. It's an extension of Him. Now, Master said here, whom the Father shall send in my name. Can there be no doubt, brothers and sisters, that the name of our Master is also Yahuwah? Isn't that awesome? So here we have a confirmation that the set-apart spirit that the Father sends is in the same name. Same as the Son, same as the Father. So all three are one in the name of Yahuwah, because a father and a son can share a name. It's just that our master is a junior, brothers and sisters. A junior. It's not a hard concept. Scriptures, they didn't use the word junior in scriptural biblical times like we do today. But that's exactly what our master is and was when he was here on earth. He's a junior. It says that he shall all teach you all and remind you of all that I said to you. Isn't that wonderful? Why? Because it's a learning process that we are slowly being helped to understand. Now turn to John 14, John 14, verse 26. 14, verse 26, and that would be, let's see here. Or no, excuse me. No, that's the final one. Okay, so now, all right. So now let's talk about the Trinity, because this is where you see that the Trinity kind of begins to get muddled up. Muddling something is a mixing of things, and it gets all mixed together, and it gets convoluted, and people kind of, they don't really understand or know. So what I'm going to do today is talk about various scriptures that people believe proves the Trinity, but why it's not. Why they want to force it to be where the Father, the Spirit, and the Son are one person, literally one being, when they are not. When the scriptures are very clear about what we have just talked about, the relationship between the Father and the Son and the set-apart Spirit, even the relationship between us and them as well. Turn to 1 Corinthians 8, chapter 6. 1 Corinthians 8, chapter 6. Or chapter 8, verse 6, excuse me. It says, "For there is one Eloah-Yaham, the Father, from whom all came, and for whom we live, and one Master, Yahuwah Moshiach, through whom all came, and through whom we live." Now, wait a minute. How, if the Father and the Son are separate, how could all come from the Father and all come from the Son? It's very easy to look at this scripture and say, well, they must be one. But they're not, because other scriptures show there's a separate relationship there, clearly. So they are one in that. The Father did create all things. He created his Son. So yes, creation came through all things, but by way of his Son, Junior, Yahuwah, the Son. Yahuwah, the Father, creates his Son, and then his Son created all things as an extension of the Father. That's how we know that it is a true statement that our Messiah is also the one whom all came through. And it's not hard to understand that, because there are various other scriptures that show this. Even scriptures in the Old Testament, which there are statements of the Father, of Yahuwah creating and Master creating and Savior. And there's all kinds of scriptures in it. And it's hard for people to, because they don't understand the relationship, they get very confused. They think, well, the Old Testament must be referring only to the Father. No. Our Master was active in the Old Testament as well, before he ever came. There were things that he was and did, and Yahuwah used him. But he was never elevated to the level that Yahuwah eventually elevated him to. Why? Because look at the angels, look at Shaitan, look at the third of the angels that fell, that rebelled. Yahuwah gave all creation free will, including you and me. And free will is a wonderful thing. I will choose free will. There's a song from a rock band that is about having free will. Now, having free will is not doing what thou wilt. You can use it for bad, or you can use it for good. Because free will means that you have the right to choose to do the right thing. You have the right to do that. And we do as Yahuwah's people. So it says that in 1 Corinthians 8:6 that we all came from Master. So when we talk about the Creator, there's the great Creator, the grand Creator, Yahuwah the Father, and then there's the one that He created first, His Son, His first creation, who created all things after. And although Genesis doesn't go into that relationship specifically about everything being created, we know that our Master is specifically shown here to be that. 2 Corinthians 3:17. Let's turn there together. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17. And it says, now Yahuwah is the Spirit. Isn't that wonderful? We talked about, you know, in many have still teach that the Spirit is a separate entity. It's not. It is Yahuwah. Yahuwah is the Spirit. That's why, brothers and sisters, if you talk, the scriptures say, if you speak out against the Spirit, that you're blaspheming and it's unforgivable. That's the same as blaspheming Yahuwah the Father, because it is Yahuwah the Father. And it says, where the Spirit of Yahuwah is, there is freedom. Yes, there's free will to choose. This is, and you can choose better or worse. That's why a third of the angels chose to do what they wanted. And I have to believe that they felt that they would have, that they would be able to simply do badness, and that they could do whatever they want and get away with it. But that's not right. There's going to be consequences. There's consequences for you and me, even in our imperfect state. We have to make choices and decisions and changes. We can't just go, oh, well, I'm imperfect. This is what I do. No. This is a constant fight, a constant battle to do the right thing as Yahuwah's people. Now, previous to verse 17, what does it say? It says, when one turns to the Master, the veil is taken away. Okay? That's because He gives us those spiritual bifocals to see and to decipher and understand. Verse 18, we all, as with unveiled face, we see as in a mirror this esteem of Yahuwah. Because see, we are not able to look upon the Father. Remember that? It says no one has looked upon the Father and lived. See? So what is the esteem of our Father? It is truly our Master, who was brought as the right arm of Yahuwah the Father. His right arm, his main control, if you will, his main worker, his main creator. And He has made Him the esteem that is He. And our Master even said it, that we esteem Him for the esteem of the Father, that it's all acting in union together. But there's an important understanding that our Master is His own personality. He was also trialed and tribulated. Why? Because He had to be tested. Before Yahuwah was going to bring Him to this position of His right arm, right hand, even though He'd used Him to create and used Him for a lot of different things, He needed to be tested still. Just like you and me, just like the angels, to make sure that His metal was right, that He would hold up. And He was. He went through every single major test that you and I can conceive of, and He passed it. And obviously, these were tests that tested His heart. And if it was so easy for Him to just perfectly not be tempted, then none of these tests would have even mattered. Why even bother? Why would Shaitan bother to test Him for 40 days with all things if He didn't believe that some of these temptations could have pulled at Him? Because there is the ability to be tempted even by perfect spirit creatures. We tend to look at our Master as, you know, being this deity, right? The world teaches that He's God, that He's a Trinity. So what happens is you look at Him this way and He's not humanized. But He came here so that we could see the humanity of Him. And even if he had never come here, he was still an angelic being like all the other angels who was able to be tempted. But he passed the temptation, whereas a third of those angels did not in the Great War. So he's the esteem. And we are being transformed into the same likeness from esteem to esteem, it says, as from Yahuwah the Spirit. Isn't that interesting context there? Being transformed into the same likeness. That's what you and I are being done. Master was the likeness of Yahuwah, and we are being transformed into that same likeness. We are being refined, and it's being done from the spirit, the Ruach of Yahuwah, is actively changing you and me. Shaitan right now is seeking to transform the world in many ways. He is deceiving through quantum changes. That's the biggest one right now. That's the big lie, if you will. Then he is also terraforming the earth, transforming it, trying to change weather and different things about the earth. He's doing it, physical changes to the earth, doing it through manipulation in the sky, energy, all sorts of different things that are being perverted. He's manipulating also the very DNA of people. He's doing it through inoculations and injections and doing it through quantum changes and manipulations, and he's manipulating the very being of men. And then he's also manipulating the minds of people. And he does this with another way. And this is through Hollywood. This is through the music industry. This is through the churches of this world, the harlot, which is all religion. It's not one religion like the world is taught. Oh, well, it's a Catholic religion, or oh, it's the Muslim religion, or it's this or that. No, it's all religion. All religion is the harlot. All of it. Which is why it's all going to come crashing down. And so he is also manipulating. He is terraforming. He is trying to change. But we are being transformed into the likeness of Yahuwah. He can't change you. He can't change what you know. Oh, he can try. And if some of the elect even might be fooled. Because there are some elect out there who will look at this whole Mandela thing and the whole quantum thing and all these other things, go, oh, that's just a conspiracy theory. I don't want to go into that. I don't want to believe any of that stuff. Conspiracy people, you know, are whack jobs, right? We're nuts. We're just completely out of our minds. That's what the world teaches. That's what the news media teaches. There are no such things as conspiracies, right? Oh, if everybody starts to believe something, then it's no longer a conspiracy for some reason. Isn't that funny? So everybody knows that John F. Kennedy was assassinated, and it wasn't just the guy that Oswald who was the one that they claimed did it. That used to be this major conspiracy theory, and if you believed anything other than Oswald shot JFK, you were a conspiracy nut. Now everybody believes and knows that it wasn't just him, that there was a conspiracy, and of course it's no longer a conspiracy because conspiracies aren't real, according to the world. But we know that that's just more deception. The greatest conspiracy is that Shaitan would remove the name of Yahuwah from the lips and minds of men. That was the greatest conspiracy going back thousands of years. And also to muddle up everything as we've been teaching about here. But we are being transformed. And so we can see with our spiritual glasses. Let's turn now to 2 Corinthians 2:9. Let's go over to that one. And it says, because in him dwells all the completeness of the mightiness bodily. Now the world wants to use this scripture as a Trinity scripture also, but it's not. Because Yahuwah does dwell in him. He dwells in you. So that's not a scripture that proves or even remotely shows that our master is a God. He is not. But that's one that they'll use. Turn to Isaiah 9, verse 6. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. This is another scripture they'll use. It says, "For a child shall be born unto us, a son shall be given unto us, and the ruler is on his shoulder, and his name is called Wonder, Counselor, Strong, El, Father of Continuity, Prince of Peace." Okay, now, a child is born to us. It's true. This is talking about and prophesying, Yeshayahu, prophesying that Master would come, that a son should be given to us, and the rule is on his shoulder. In other words, Yahuwah has placed him to be our king. That's why they call him Christ, because Christ means king. And his name is called. Now, this is what's important here. This is where the Trinitarians, the first problem with people that are taught these Trinity doctrines, they don't even know the name of Yahuwah. They don't even know the importance of the name. They don't understand what that means. And we know the great name of the Father was given to the Son. That's why it says, and his name is called. Okay? What is his name called? His name is called by the same name that is his Father, Yahuwah. Now that would be one way of phrasing this scripture differently. And his name is called Yahuwah, of his Father. But instead, what does it say? And his name is called Wonder, Counselor, Strong, El. Well, I'm not sure about the El. I think the El, personally, I think El is not a scriptural word. I think that is a faction of men that changed that. And there are some ancient, and so it's mistranslated. Kind of like Lord is put into Bibles. I believe the El is put also into scriptures incorrectly, because El comes from an entity that was a false god. And also because it's a name, and he only has one name. So we don't use the name El or, and even Elohim today is still used, right? That's why it's called Elohim. So you could say El is God, and Elohim is plural, which means gods. But I don't like to use that word El, because we have gone off the deep end with it. But for sake of this scripture, it El is of Elohim. Elohim means plural gods. El means one God. I don't like to use God. I don't like to use the word gods. I don't like to use El. I don't like to use Elohim. I like to just say Yahuwah or Eloah Ya'am, Almighty Loving Yahuwah, right? But it says Strong El, Father of Continuity, Prince of Peace. Why? Does this show that he is the Almighty? No. It just shows that his name is of the Almighty, of the Father, because it is. It's not Jesus. And then his Father's name is Jehovah. His name is Yahuwah, and he came from his Father, Yahuwah. And that's the root of his name. And that's essentially what Isaiah prophesied. And it is truth, especially when you know the truth of it all. Isn't that wonderful? So where this scripture teaches people that the Son is God, we know what it's really saying, because we've been given the key to the greatest understanding, which is his great name, Yahuwah, the name of his Father. And now Isaiah 44, verse 6. Turn there if you will. Actually, go back to 5. It says, one says, I belong to Yahuwah. Another calls himself by the name of Yaakov. Another writes with his hand unto Yahuwah, and names himself by the name of Yasaral. Thus said Yahuwah, sovereign of Yasaral, and his redeemer, Yahuwah of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no Eloah Ya'am. So, Yahuwah, the Father, says that he has a redeemer, Yahuwah of hosts. Well, our Master is known as the Redeemer. So doesn't this prove that they are one? No. It proves that he's sending his Son, whose name is Yahuwah. So again, where this scripture is used to prove Trinity, we can prove it to show the relationship of the great name, which is a crucial. Isn't that wonderful? Isaiah 44:6. So we have that understanding now. Turn to John 1:14. It says, "And the Word became flesh and pitched his tent among us. And we saw his esteem as of an only brought forth of a father, complete in favor and truth." Now, this is funny because, again, they try to use this as a Trinity scripture, but it's so not. First of all, it shows that the Word is the Father because it says the Word became flesh and pitched his tent among us. In other words, he set up his Son to be here among us. And it says, we saw his esteem. Yes, because his Son is a reflection. It's not him, right? He's a reflection of the Father. He's a reflection because he, in every way, followed the truth and the Word that is his Father. His Father, the beginning of all things, creating his Son. His Son is the esteem, which is the reflection of his Father. And it even says, as of an only brought forth of a father. So how much simpler can you make this in its understanding? But can you twist it? Yes. And is it? Yes. And that's why there's a hunger for truth, because the world just listens to what's being said by these men in these churches, and they don't know anything else. And they're ignorant because they're being taught ignorant things. John 10:30, and go back to John 10:28. Says, "And I give them everlasting life." He's talking about you and me, his people. "And they shall by no means ever perish, and no one shall snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. And I and my Father are one." You say, whoa, wait a minute. That's blasphemy. Yeah, the Jews thought so also. Because it says in the next scripture that they picked up stones to stone him. But you see, we are one with Master in the same way that he is one with the Father. And the scripture makes it very clear. Look up in your Bibles. Search out the scripture. This is your homework. Search out the scripture that says that you and I are one with Master in the same way that he is one with the Father. We are no more God than he is. We are no more El. We are no more Yahuwah than he is. But we are, and so is he. Because we are one with the Master in the same way, it says, that he is one with the Father. So because the world doesn't get that concept today, they understand Trinity. In the same ignorance that the Pharisees, the Yehudim, the Jews, in the same ignorance that they also understood that concept, the world today also understands it. The religious orders of Christianity today and all its factions look at that as the same thing. Not all of them, but a good majority of them. And yet, they don't see themselves as being like Pharisees. And that's exactly what they are when they try to take John 10:30 and make that as a Trinity scripture. See, sometimes scriptures will say certain things, and then the definition will be given later. And that is so that his people alone, his seekers alone, can see the truth. Now, why would Master say this? Because everything that was prophesied in scripture had to come about. And there were certain triggers, if you will, that Master utilized. Master utilized certain triggers to get them to sort of get the dander up, if you will, of the Pharisees, to get them upset at him. And this was all done for purpose, to expose them but also because they needed to accomplish what was prophesied for Master to do, which is namely that he would give up his life for all of mankind. And they were an important ingredient of that, but also so that he could expose them for what they were. If he hadn't exposed them, then we wouldn't have had this separation from the Pharisees. The whole world, you wouldn't have any Christianity, and then eventually people coming to Yahuwah, they would all be fooled by the Pharisaic order of things. But that was stopped. And this was a trigger statement by Master. I and the Father are one. Later it's developed. We understand it more. But at this time, it was to test them. It's still here to test the world and even Christianity. And there were certain things that Master held back from saying because he didn't want to trigger something immediately right then and there in that situation. If you read scriptures, you see that there were times where he held back, where he was silent, or where he said that, you know, that he was going to not do this or not do that because it wasn't yet time, right? So everything he said and did was done for a reason. When this was stated in John 10:30, it was done for a reason. It was done to test the Yehudim, and it was done to test Christians today. Those same Christians that believe in Trinity are just as outraged at what I'm saying, that this is not the understanding. Their understanding is not the right understanding of this Trinity concept. And also the Yehudim, when Master said this, also were outraged because they didn't get it either because they didn't have their glasses on. Luke 1:35. Let's turn to Luke chapter 1, verse 35. It says, "And the messenger answering said to her, 'The set-apart spirit shall come upon you, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow you. And for that reason, the set-apart one born of you shall be called Son of Eloah Ya'am.'" Well, to me, it should be very straightforward. How they use this as Trinity, I can't even begin to understand because it's so straightforward that he's the Son of Almighty. And the set-apart spirit of Yahuwah, which is one with the Father, yes, but that doesn't mean that all three are actually God. It just means that this Father has this set-apart spirit, this force, this action, this arm, that actually is the tool that he uses. It's like a wrench, so to speak. A wrench, when I use it to work on something, is no more, it is nothing more than metal. But when I use it, it now becomes a tool. It's not a tool unless you're using it for something specific. So he has a tool that is known as a set-apart spirit, which he utilizes. It's a power of him. It's an all-encompassing power. It's just very interesting. All right, so that's another scripture that is absolutely in no way proves that there's any sort of Trinity. Matthew 1:23. Let's turn to that one. Matthew 1, verse 23. And it says, verse 23, "See, a maiden shall conceive, and she shall give birth to a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which translated means "L with us." Okay, here we go with the L again. Now, when translated, it's talking about the name. They shall call his name. Okay, so our Master, his name is Yahuwah. We've been able to solidify that and see the foundation of that in Scripture. And we know his Father's name is Yahuwah. So, his name is Yahuwah. If I have the same name as my dad, if I'm a junior of my dad, and he is, and it, does that make me him? When my first name is the same as him? No. It was given me because it's a reflection of my father. I am his son. And it's a way that some fathers give the same name to their sons to sort of say, see, this is my son. I'm proud of my son. This is my firstborn. Generally, a junior is a firstborn. This is my son, and I'm proud of him, and he's just like me, and he's going to be like me, and I'm going to raise him up to see and understand what I understand and help him to know what I know. That doesn't make your son any more you, but he's a reflection of you. He might even look a lot like you because he is of you. Same thing here with the son. First of all, we know that his name, he didn't go around and people didn't call him Emmanuel or El with us. When he was on earth, his name was Yahu, and eventually Yahuwah. But there's a meaning here in Matthew 1:23. And that means that he is a son who is of the Almighty. Almighty is with us because he sent his son to be with us, which is a wonderful statement. And so the word, which is also mistranslated Emmanuel, that is a statement of the definition of who he was, basically. Not in a literal name, but even the word, his name can be translated incorrectly, the understanding. It could say something like, and they shall know him by his name, because he is of Yahuwah the Father among us. Different ways of translating verse 23 of Matthew 1. But in no way does this even remotely show that there is a trinity of the Father and the Son and the set-apart Spirit all being God. In no way. It just means, again, he's a reflection. Matthew 28:19 says, therefore go and make taught ones, or disciples, of all the nations, immersing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the set-apart Spirit. Yes, that's because there is only one name for all three of them, not because all three are one. So you see the deception, where what Shaitan decided to do was he decided to use these religious organizations to muddle this up. And instead of you understanding that all three of these would have the same name and that this name is important, he decided to use them to teach the world that the Father's name is Jehovah, that the Son's name is Jesus, that the set-apart Spirit doesn't really have a name. We don't call it by a name because they're all one. Well, then why do you call Jesus Jesus and Jehovah Jehovah? Or whatever name you use, Yahweh, whatever name you use for the Father, whatever name you use for the Son, if you say Yeshua or Yahushua, whatever names you use, you should be using one name. Because all three things here have one name, Yahuwah. And that's it, friends. And it's very simple. And it's very straightforward. This is a definition of what the great name is, not a definition that all three of these are God. But so that this becomes muddled and muddied up, Shaitan uses the religious orders to teach this as a Trinity doctrine. So if you wanted to know what is the name of the set-apart Spirit, it defines it right here. We know what the set-apart Spirit is, that it is an active force of our Father, but what is its name? Its name is Yahuwah. What is the Son's name? Yahuwah. And what is the Father's name? Yahuwah. Isn't that wonderful? Let's go to the next scripture now, which is Matthew 3:16 and 17. It says, and having been immersed, Yahu went up immediately from the water, and see, the heavens were open. He saw the Spirit of Elohim descending like a dove and coming upon him. See that? The Spirit of Yahuwah, which actually he is of with Mary, his mother, Mariam, came upon him and descended upon him. Why? Because he was not Yahuwah the Father. He's separate. But Yahuwah gives his Spirit to his Son. He even gives it to you and to I, we pray. He has given his Spirit, has come upon many people of Yahuwah. Doesn't make them God because the Spirit comes upon you. You don't become a God. But you become one with Yahuwah the Father, just like the Son becomes one with Yahuwah the Father, because it's the concept. And what literally happens, there's a transformation. And so our Master, in verse 16, He no more is the Father because of this scripture than you and I are. But yet Trinitarians will use this scripture to somehow try to show that our Master is a God, or is God. It says, in the voice of the heavens, saying, verse 17, this is my Son, the Beloved, in whom I did delight. Now this is another thing. I remember in whom I do delight, or in whom I delight, is what I remember, brothers and sisters. And I have found in Scripture a couple of times now, and in all other translations, a past tense word put in here that I believe was not there before. Whom I did delight. That doesn't make any sense. He does delight. The reason why this is important to me is because my name, Denia, means delights in Yahuwah. And so when I've always read this word delight, it's always made me happy because I want to be the delight of Yahuwah. I'm not always. But I try to be, and I want to be more and more, just like you do. And so this scripture is always, for the last 10 years, if you will, now almost 10 years, has had great meaning to me. Because of the meaning of my name, when I found out Denia means delights in Yahuwah. So these scriptures, there's a few of them that this states it again. Never did I read whom I did delight. Now could I be wrong? I could be, but I remember what I remember, and I remember in whom I delight, because it wasn't past tense that he did delight. He delights in him now. He'll be delighting in him in the future because he knows what's going to occur. He knows what his Son passed the test to be able to be part of his right arm now and to do what he's going to have him do. So that's just a little bit of a sidebar on some of the changes that I believe are occurring also. But let's turn now to John 14, 16 to 17. John 14, 16 and 17. It says, and I shall ask the Father, and he shall give you another helper to stay with you forever. What's that? He says, the Spirit of the truth, whom the world is unable to receive, because it did not see him or know him, but you know him, for he stays with you and shall be in you. Brothers and sisters, that Spirit is the helper. It's the Ruach. It's the set-apart Spirit of Yahuwah. It is of Yahuwah. It's what he sent upon his Son. And it says that he's going to give you a helper to stay with you forever. Does it say that he's going to give it to you and take it away and let you fall? No, because when he gives it to you, it's forever. So fight. Because if you believe, as I believe, that he has given me the Spirit of truth, I don't doubt it. And though we are imperfect and we make mistakes and we're working to refine ourselves, it doesn't mean that he takes it away from you because you are imperfect. No. It says he'll stay with you forever. Do you believe it? Do you know it? Do you see it? Yes. He says in verse 18, I shall not leave you orphans, but I am coming to you. Yet a little while, and the world no longer sees me, but shall see me, because I live and you shall live. In that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Because we're all one in the right context. The right understanding, the name, and the set apart Spirit which comes upon us. Hallelujah. Romans 14, 17 to 18. The Spirit, friends, is just helping us decimate this Trinity doctrine. Hallelujah. And that's what we're doing today. It says, for the reign of Eloah Ya'am is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the set-apart Spirit. For he who is serving Messiah in these matters is well-pleasing to Eloah Ya'am and approved by men. So they try to use this as another doctrine, but it doesn't even add up or make any sense at all. The reign of Eloah Ya'am. Well, we know what Eloah Ya'am is, the Father. We know that his extension is his Son who he moved to his right hand. So you could say that Eloyam is reigning, absolutely, because he sent his son to reign over us. Just like you can say the Father is the creator, but then he created his son who he had create all things. It doesn't negate the fact that both of them are creators. The creator, the ultimate creator, is Yahuwah. The ultimate reign is of Yahuwah, even though he sends his son. Isn't that wonderful? So, again, context is everything. Luke 3:21-22. Turn there if you would. It says, "And it came to be when all the people were immersed, Yahuwah also being immersed in praying, the heaven was opened, and the set-apart spirit descended in bodily like a dove upon him. And a voice came, said, 'You are my son, the beloved, in whom you I did delight.'" Again, with the did, another, you know, that I believe has been changed. "I feel it. I sense it. I do not remember. I past tense delighted." Genesis 1:1-2. Another scripture that they use. "In the beginning, Eloyam created the heavens and the earth, and the earth came to be, formless and empty, and darkness upon the face of the deep. And the spirit of Eloyam was moving on the face of the waters." Again, yes, he did create all things, but he did so through his son. Does Genesis 1 go into the overall aspect of how it was done exactly? No, there. My goodness, you could spend almost eternity defining exactly what's being said here in Genesis 1 by virtue of what Yahuwah did and with his son. And by the way, how do we not know that Yahuwah didn't create and start one aspect of the dimensions only to have his son finish it up? We don't. And I think anybody in the right context in their head, understanding the relationship of the Father and the Son and the set-apart Spirit in you and I, understands clearly the order of things without some Trinitarian doctrine and lie. 1 John 5:7-8. 1 John 5:7-8. Turn there. And he says, "Because there are three who bear witness, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and all three are in agreement." Now, some are going to say, "Well, you're not reading the King James Version. It says something, you know, it's completely different." All right, let's read King James. It says, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit and the water and the blood. And these three agree in one." Okay, so there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the set-apart Spirit. And these three are one. Well, they are one, because the Father is the Word. Yes, he created his Son, who also is the Word. He couldn't have been a reflection if he wasn't the Word. But it doesn't make him God. It doesn't make him almighty. It makes him mighty, but it doesn't make him almighty. And the Holy Ghost, boy, if you look up the understanding of the word holy and ghost, the word holy comes from holly, the holly plant, which was a... Again, it's an idolistic, satanic creation. So holy is not a good word to use. And ghost, we know what ghosts are. And it's just a very wicked term, Holy Ghost. And the King James is just filled with all these Baal words like Lord, and they removed the great name. And some like to revere King James Version. I don't. I certainly don't revere it at all. And I find it actually more disgusting. I worry about people that find it more set apart than other Bibles, because I'll tell you what, if there's one Bible I believe is less set apart than the others, I believe it's the King James Version. And I know it's the most common, but to me it's the most disgusting. And oddly enough, it is also receiving the most changes with the Mandela quantum effect. Interesting, isn't it? How the King James is more affected than other Bibles. But anyway, getting back, yes, they agree. They're in agreement. The Spirit, the water, and the blood. Being in agreement does not mean you're one. Verse 7 talks about a straightforward statement. The Father, the Word, and the set-apart Spirit are one. Yes, it's true. If you want to call the Word a separate person being our master, Yahuwah, you're wrong. He is the Word, but the Father is the Word first. He got that from his Father. The covenant Word is of Yahuwah the Father. It is the Father. It is his covenant. And the Word is him, and he is the Word, and he made his Son to be a reflection of that Word also. But the Father and the Word and the set-apart Spirit are one because they are. And that is not Trinity, and that is not to confuse his Son as Almighty. And then when it says the Spirit and the water and the blood agree, they do agree. It doesn't make them one to be in agreement. My wife and I are in agreement on a lot of things. It doesn't make her Dennis. Thank goodness. That would be no fun for me. So it's important to know that. My son, Donovan, he is my son, but he is no more me than I am him, even though he comes from me. So again, twisted to become something other than what it really means. Spiritual glasses on. 1 Peter 1, 1 and 2. Peter, an apostle, or Kepha, an emissary of Yahuwah Moshiach, to the chosen strangers of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, chosen according to the foreknowledge of Elohim the Father, set apart by the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Yahuwah Moshiach, favor and peace be increased upon you. Chosen according to the foreknowledge of Elohim the Father. So, again, let's read what King James says. Because, again, you're going to have a lot of the King James worshipers are going to say, well, read it here. It says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Nothing here states that our Master is one, that he is God. It just says chosen according to the foreknowledge. And when you compare that to some of the other scriptures, like the ESV version, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in the sanctification of the Spirit, that's one translation, or the people chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit to be obedient to Jesus Christ and to be sprinkled with his blood. Nowhere in there does it say anything about our Master being God or being one with him or that he is almighty. But yet they'll try to use that somehow. Turning to 2 Corinthians 1, verse 21 and 22. It says, for since in the wisdom of Elohim, the world through wisdom did not know Elohim, it pleased Elohim through the foolishness of preaching to save those who believe. That doesn't sound right either to me anymore, that scripture. Foolishness of preaching. Is preaching really ever foolish? I mean, it could be. But foolish preaching does not save people who believe. What saves people is the truth, the word, the unadulterated word of Yahuwah. And it is not foolishness. So, verse 22 says, and since you Yehudim ask a sign and Greeks seek wisdom. Oh, you know what? I'm in the wrong. I'm not in 2 Corinthians. Let me apologize. Let me turn to 2 Corinthians 1. Thought that was weird, but that's very interesting. Thank you, Father, for that scripture, because there is no foolishness in preaching the truth, right? Very interesting that that would, a little mistake there. But anyway, further, it says in verse 1 of 2 Corinthians 1:1, it says, Shaul, an emissary of Yahuwah Moshiach, by the desire of Elohim, and Timothy the brother, to the assembly of Elohim, that is at Corinth, with all the set-apart ones who are in all of Achaia, favor to you and peace from Elohim our Father and the Master Yahuwah Moshiach. How does that prove that they're one? Any more than if I was to say, I bid you greetings from my grandfather and from my father. So I think it's straightforward not to dwell on that. I don't see how you could possibly twist that. First Corinthians 12, 4 through 6, it says, "And there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of services, but the same Master." Okay? Nowhere in that does it state that our Master is a God. In verse 6, "And there are different kinds of workings, but it is the same Eloi-Am who is working in all." That is a fact. So our gifts that we get from Yahuwah comes from His Ruach. His Ruach. The truth and the work and all that Master did is also a reflection of the Father, because He sent His Son to do these things. Doesn't make Him the Father any more than it makes angels that Yahuwah uses for different services as well to do different things, which the scriptures are very clear about. Gabriel, what he does, and other angels, archangels, they're no more God than our Master would be God. Why? They're no more almighty than our Master would be almighty, because they all have services to do, and they do them, and they are sent by Yahuwah. It doesn't make them Yahuwah. The Almighty makes Him servants of Yahuwah. And, of course, workings that Yahuwah does work in all of us. He works in His Son. He works in you and I. And it doesn't mean that they are one. All right, so that was 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 6. Now let's go to Ephesians 4, 4 through 6. Another scripture. And it says, "One body, one Spirit, as you also were called in one expectation of your calling, one Master, one belief, one immersion, one Eloi-Am and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all." Yes, it doesn't mean He's in His that Master is the Father of all. He's of His Father, who is above all, and it makes a distinction. But yet He's in all of us. He's in our Master. There's one body and one Spirit. Yes, because it is the Spirit of Yahuwah. Does that mean that all three are one? Literally? No. No more so than you and I are gods. But you know who would teach you that you are God? Shaitan. Yes, he would. That's a deception of the satanic church, that you are all gods. It's a deception that you are all going to be gods in another life. We are of Almighty, but we are not Almighty. He created us all, just like He created His Son. But His Son is not Almighty. So again, that fails and falls flat on its face. Colossians 1, 15 to 16. And it says, "Who is the likeness of the invisible Eloi-Am, the firstborn of all creation." So first of all, He's the likeness. Just because something is like something doesn't make it that. I can create a likeness of the painting Mona Lisa. It doesn't make it the original painting of Mona Lisa. Right? He's the likeness of Eloi-Am. But what's interesting is it shows too that He was the firstborn of all creation. That's what makes Him also the Creator, because He was the first. And then of Him all things came through. So the Father creates the Son, who's the firstborn, and of all creation. And it says, "Because in Him were created all, because of Him were created all that are in the heavens and that are on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or rulerships or principalities or authorities, all have been created through Him and for Him. And He is before all, and in Him all hold together. And He is the head of the body, the assembly, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that He might become the one who is first in all. Because in Him all the completeness was well pleased to dwell." So friends, yes, He was first created, and everything was created from Him. So you learn something today. You learn that Yahuwah created all things, but He did so through His Son. And the scriptures are evident, self-evident in that regard, not stating that they are the same person. Why would He need to create the Son if the Son is Him? He would just say, "I created all things, and I don't need any firstborn because I do all things. But he did things structurally. But there is a group, the Jews, who do not believe in that the firstborn has come, that he is here. They say, well, there's going to be a savior, but you get the sense they really don't. If they really truly wanted to believe in a savior, they would have once upon a time. They don't. John 14:9-11, it says that Yahuwah said to him, have I been with you so long and you have not known me, Philip? He's really saying that to the world. Don't you know me yet? Don't you understand the relationship? He says, he who has seen me has seen the Father. And how do you say, show us the Father? Why? Because he's the reflection of his Father. Because he's the Word, which the Word is his Father. Created to be that exact representation. After all, he was firstborn. He says, do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak from myself, but the Father who stays in me does his works. So, because we know the truth, that I am, that you and I are one in him, the way he is one in the Father, because we know that from other scriptures, we are able to understand this context. Hallelujah. Philippians 2:5-8. We're going to try to get through as many of these as possible because these are all the scriptures that Trinitarians use. 2:5-8. It says, for let this mind be in you, which was also in Moshiach, Yahuwah, who being in the form of Eloiam, did not regard equality with Eloiam a matter to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and came to be in the likeness of men. So Yahuwah breaks it down, brothers and sisters, as simply as possible. The understanding as simply as possible. It's very complex, but it's very straightforward. In the way that we know it, in the way that he has taught it, in the way that he has designed it. Simple. Father, Son, you, me. Father and Spirit poured out upon the Son, poured out upon you and me. We are all of Yahuwah, but we are not Almighty, for there is only one Almighty that we just read. So again, no more a Trinitarian scripture unless it's twisted to become something else. John 10:30-36, 33. It says, I and my Father are one. And the Yahudim picked up stones to stone him. Yahu answered them, many good works I have shown you from my Father. Because of which of these works do you stone me? So the Yahudim answered him, saying, we do not stone you for good work, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself Eloiam. So again, because they didn't understand what he was saying. And he knew they didn't understand it. And he knew what they would do when he said it. So he says, Yahuwah answered them, is it not written in your own Torah? I said, you are Eloiam. If he called them Eloiam, to whom the word of Eloiam came, and it is impossible for the scriptures to be broken, do you say of him who the Father set apart and sent into the world, you are blaspheming because I said, I am son of Eloiam? If I do not do the works of my Father, do not believe me. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, so that you know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him am in him. So, again, he defines what he's saying. He's saying the Father's in me. He's saying that the Word is impossible to be broken. He's saying that all these things were done, and all these works and all these services are being done by many, not just him, which is interesting, because he says isn't it written in your own book? He says that the word, how it came to be. And it says that, do you say of him who the Father set apart and sent into the world, you're blaspheming because I said I am son of Eloiam, defining what he's actually saying? He says son of Eloiam because he still didn't get it. And so they wanted to say that because he declared, he made the statement that I and the Father are one, that you don't get it. It's so simple. I'm the son of Elohim. He says it in verse 36. Well, how can he be the son if he's one with the Father? In the same way that he taught that you and I are one with him, in the same way, which they wouldn't accept, they wouldn't hear it, they wouldn't listen to it, they weren't allowed to. So there's a reason that Paul could not hear or see or understand unless he was made blind and allowed to have those scales removed from his eyes, if you will, from his brain. There was no way that Paul was going to see. Friends, the world is the same as Paul. The only reason he was allowed to see is because Yahuwah forced it to happen. Paul was so fortunate that Yahuwah did that to him, or he never would have been able to see. None of these Yehudim can see. And if you have been able to see these things and understand these things, then you count yourself fortunate, because the people that believe in the Trinity doctrine, you can go through and explain these things, but they're not going to believe any of this because they're not allowed to. You are. So praise Yahuwah for that, dear brothers and sisters. Praise Yahuwah that he has allowed you to see and understand and believe and to know the truth, so that you can help others to see that every one of these scriptures, 30 plus scriptures today we've read on that are encompass the entire Trinity doctrine that Yahuwah has allowed us to show and poke holes through, completely showing the true relationship. The Father is the Father, and the set apart Spirit is a part of him. It is him. It is also named Yahuwah. And his Son, whose name is Yahuwah, is an extension, a reflection of him, not him, but his right arm, created by him, who created all things through him, and is our master, that you are one in, I am one in, the same that he is one in, the almighty loving name that is Yahuwah.
This concludes this seventh day audio broadcast of It's Time for Truth. I'm your servant host, Denya Cajaliero, and you need to know that your comments, suggestions, and support are very, very important to us here. Please send your contact email directly to praiseyahuwah@yahoo.com, or go to our contact webpage by clicking on the phone icon at the homepage at www.praiseyahuwah.com. This is the day that Yahuwah has made, so rejoice and be glad in it. Until next week, be a blessing to all, and be blessed.